Welcome to the first talk of the three lecture series on Unity of Mathematics by Professor Michelle Walschmidt. Professor Michelle Walschmidt is an emeritus professor at Université Jésuite of Paris, where he has been teaching for past 40 years. He specializes in number theory, focusing on transcendental numbers and Alphandian approximation. He has also published in various other areas like algebraic geometry, complex analysis, analytic spaces, history, biography, etc. Professor Walschmidt is a highly cited researcher with 200 publications, including 16 books to his credit. He has been actively involved in promoting and popularizing mathematics in developing countries and has lectured in more than 70 countries. So it's my great pleasure to invite Professor Walschmidt for the talk, Examples from Transcendental Number Theory.
Yes, it's better. So thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you for the invitation. I came many times to this place. The first time, it was with Balasubramanian long back. And then I visited Chantal Eshram a couple of times. And since I came rather often here, Vijay Patankar suggested that maybe I could go to JNU. I already went to JNU, thanks to the invitation of Ridisha. And I said, OK, I can give a series of lectures. And now this series of lectures takes place here. And I am very glad of this opportunity. When Vijay suggested me the topic, which is the unity of mathematics, just when I read this, I was a bit skeptical about what I could say. And then rather soon, I found that I could speak on unity of mathematics, given the fact that there are a lot of connections between transcendental number theory, which is my main field, Diophantine approximation, and a number of other topics in mathematics. My thesis advisor, Jean Fresnel in Bordeaux, was a specialist of Ivar-Zavar theory. There are also some connections with the representation theory, with abelian varieties, with the arithmetic complexity. I mentioned these topics because these are among the many specialties of Vijay. And so I thought I could try to explain something about these connections. The connections are in several ways. Some connections are due to the fact that in transcendental numbers theory, in the proofs, we need some facts from other parts of mathematics. And so we apply theories which a priori do not seem very closely related with transcendental numbers. And there is also another type of connection, which is that the results of transcendental number theory are used in other parts of mathematics. So I will try to discuss several examples. Not all of them. I found many possible topics which I will not cover for lack of time, even with the three lectures. I will not cover all of mathematics. I am sorry that I do not speak so much on probability, but I will cover several topics. I would like to insist, especially with the students, on the fact that very often the main progress in mathematics arises when someone, some mathematician, uses some tools from a topic to solve a problem in some topic which looks unrelated. These kind of new connections which are made between several parts of mathematics are extremely fruitful. So if you want to be a good mathematician, you should not only specialize in a field, you should also be interested in most fields of mathematics. And so the center of my talks will be on transcendental number theory. What is the question? The question is, when you are given a number, say a real number, x, the basic question is to decide whether x is rational or not. So the main word here is given. What does it mean to give a number? If you give the number using the decimal expansion or the binary expansion, then the answer is essentially known. If the expansion in any basis 2, 3, 10, if one expansion is periodic, the number is rational, and if the ultimately periodic. So the start may be anything, and then you repeat. If the expansion is not periodic, the number is irrational. This is a very nice criterion, but it's not so useful. We do not use it for the following reason. The numbers which are given arise from analysis. And most often, we do not know the decimal or the binary expansion of the numbers which arise from analysis. So arising from analysis, I mean that they are given as limits of series, as integrals. Ah. So I continue. The numbers which we are interested in arise from analysis. They are given as a limit of series, of integrals, of infinite products. And almost always, we do not know the binary expansion or the decimal expansion. So the decimal expansion criterion is a nice result, but it's not so useful. There are other criteria. For example, if you have the continued fraction expansion, which means that you write your number x as an integer plus, so if it is an integer, you are finished, it is rational. And then if it is not an integer, you can write it as an integer plus 1 over x1, where a0 is an integer and x1 is greater than 1. And then you repeat x1
less than 1.
Greater than 1. Yes, x is between a0. So a0 is the integral part of x. And so the x1, you can write it as a1 plus 1 over x2. Well, if x1 is an integer, then x is rational. Otherwise, you write it like this, with x2, which is greater than 1, and a1 is an integer. So if the process stops, the number is rational. And it is not so difficult to see that if the process does not stop, then the number is irrational. So we have an irrationality criterion. And now the question is, are there some numbers for which we know the continued fraction expansion? There are algebraic numbers for which we know them. There are also transcendental numbers. For example, Euler proved that the number e, for e, you get the sequence a0, a1, a2, which is the following. You have 2, 1, 2, 1, 1, 4, 1, 1, 6, and so on. So you see, you repeat 1 to n, 1, for n equal 1, 2, 3. So it's an infinite fraction, and therefore the number e, the basis of the exponential, is an irrational number. The proof is not that easy, and this is not the easiest proof of irrationality of e. But it's very rare that we know the continued fraction expansion of a number which arises from analysis. There are exceptions, but not so many. So we want to find some other method. The numbers which we are looking at will be numbers like e, pi, log 2, Euler constant, which is given as the limit of the sum of I equal 1 up to n of 1 over I minus log n. These are the kind of numbers that we are interested in. And so to get some results on these numbers, we need to introduce some tools And the most efficient one is the tools which arise from Diophantine approximation. It's the fact that essentially all the proofs of transcendence, of irrationality, rest on Diophantine approximation. And if you look at the proof, somewhere in the proof, you have the basic result. Which is the fact that the integers is an Archimedean set, which is that if you have an integer n, which is non-zero, then the absolute value of n is greater than or equal to 1. So it's a very elementary result. But in some disguise, it will come into the proof of the irrationality of transcendence. We need some generalization of this result. And the first one is if you take a rational number p over q, which is not zero, then p over q is greater than or equal to 1 over q. So when I write p over q, I will mean that p is an integer and q is greater than or equal to 1. Usually, I do not need to assume that p and q are relatively prime. So this is the basic result of, these are the two basic results of Diophantine approximation, but of course they are related. Here we have a low bound which is an absolute low bound. Here we have an absolute low bound which depends on the number p over q. And of course we cannot do better. And so we will need some generalization of these results to algebraic numbers. Oh, yes. So to generalize this to algebraic numbers, we need to introduce something which is called the height. So first of all, I have to define what is an algebraic number. An algebraic number, so if you have a number alpha, let me say that it's a complex number. If you prefer, you restrict to real numbers. A complex number is algebraic if there exists a non-zero polynomial, say with coefficients in the integers, so that p of alpha is equal to zero. So alpha is a root of a polynomial with integer coefficients. So we can write this as a0 alpha to the d plus a1 alpha d minus 1 plus ad equals 0. This polynomial is not the zero polynomial. I can write it with a0 which is non-zero, and we can take a0 which is positive. So this will be the agreement. And the generalization of, well, we when we have a rational number, we will define the height of p over q as the maximum of p and q. And we need a generalization when we have an algebraic number. There are many generalizations, but what we need is to define the height of alpha in such a way that the set of numbers of bounded degree and bounded height is a finite set. So, bounded degree and bounded height is finite. There are many possible definitions. One which is called the naive height is to take the maximum of A0, A1, AD. This is one definition, but there are many others, and they are equivalent, essentially, and this is more or less the same as the equivalence of norms on a finite dimensional vector space. And so, if they are equivalent, we can expect that there is not one which is better than the others. And it turned out that this is not exactly true. There is one which is better than the others, because this one has several definitions. And this is the so-called absolute height. And the absolute height can be defined in several equivalent ways. And because of that, it is very useful, and it has a lot of application, in particular to diophantine geometry. So the absolute height is obtained, for example, as follows. You write this polynomial P of x. So the leading term is A0, which is positive. And then you have a polynomial which is monic. It has integer coefficients. In C, it has D roots. And the roots, you can write them as alpha I equal 1 up to D, of x minus alpha I. And one of the roots, say alpha 1, is alpha. Because I didn't say yet, but I will say now. Yes, thank you. So there are many polynomials which satisfy this property. There exists some polynomial. And if you take such a polynomial and all the multiples, again, it satisfies this. So we will take for P the minimal polynomial. So we take the one of the least degree. So this is what will be defined as the degree of alpha, the smallest degree of a polynomial vanishing on alpha. And the absolute height of alpha is defined as h of alpha is A0 times the product for I equal 1 up to D of the maximum of 1 and alpha I. So why is it so useful to have this definition, which may look a little bit special? It is because this can be written also as the exponential of the integral from 0 to 1 of the logarithm of the absolute value of p of exponential 2 I pi t dt. So if you use the Jensen formula, you get this equality. And there is also a third definition, which involves a product for the absolute values of alpha. And the absolute values of alpha, you have the complex ones, which are the module of alpha I, and you have the p-adic ones. So this involves p-adic numbers. Right now, I will not say more about p-adic numbers, but come back to p-adic numbers later. So this is the absolute height, and this absolute height plays a very important role in several domains of diophantine geometry. In particular, for the results on the finiteness of integral points on a curve of genus at least 2, and even genus at least 1 if we take the integral points. So the proofs of this finiteness results rest heavily on some properties of height. This is the height of an algebraic number. This is not the end of the story. There are some objects which are more complicated than algebraic numbers, which are the subvarieties of a given variety. So if you take a variety, you have some subvarieties, and you can define the height of a subvariety of a variety, even the height of a variety itself. If you do that for elliptic curves and for abelian varieties, you get the Arakelov, right? And I will come back to Arakelov theory later in connection with the method of transcendental number theory. In diophantine geometry, when you work with elliptic curves or abelian varieties, there is a notion of the Néron-Tate height. And this Néron-Tate height uses the structure of the abelian variety, but it starts with the absolute height that I defined here. So now that we have this tool, this definition of the height, I wish to explain why there is some so deep connection between Diophantine approximation and transcendental number theory. To prove the existence of transcendental numbers is something which took a long time. Even the definition of what is a transcendental number, which I did not give so far. So let me give the definition. A transcendental number is a number which is not algebraic. The logic behind the word transcendental. The word transcendental was introduced by Leibniz. And it's interesting that Leibniz was also a philosopher. And so Leibniz introduced the name transcendental numbers, but the concept was not as clear as the one which is there. And even when the first examples of transcendental numbers were given by Liouville in 1844, Liouville does not speak of transcendental numbers in his paper. He speaks of numbers which are not algebraic and not even reducible to algebraic numbers. And so it took some time before this appears like this, but the name itself, transcendental, comes from Leibniz. And so if you want to prove that a number is transcendental, you have to prove that you have this number, and whenever you take a non-zero polynomial, this polynomial will not have the given number as a root, which is something which looks a little bit difficult. There is one way to get the existence of transcendental numbers, which is the way which was used by Georges Cantor, which is to say that almost all numbers, say complex numbers, it's true also for the real numbers, are transcendental. What means almost? It means for Lebesgue's measure, it was not the way that Cantor phrased it, but the idea is to prove that the set of algebraic numbers is a countable set. The set of real numbers is not a countable set, or the set of complex numbers, and therefore we deduce at least that there are some numbers which are transcendental. But this is not a very efficient way to prove that some given number is transcendental. The first example of transcendental numbers was given before Cantor by Liouville. And Liouville proved a property which is satisfied by all algebraic numbers. And then he constructed some numbers which do not satisfy this property, and therefore these numbers are transcendental. It's important to understand that Liouville started by studying algebraic numbers, and then he deduced some transcendence result. It's very often what we do when we have a transcendence proof. we want to prove that some number like e pi is a transcendental number. So we can start by assuming that the number is algebraic. And then during the proof, we have only algebraic numbers. So all the proof is algebraic. And at the end, we have a contradiction. So the proofs of transcendental numbers are proofs which lie in the field of algebraic numbers. It's a field, as a matter of fact. Transcendental numbers is not a field, but algebraic numbers is a field. And so this is why in transcendence methods, we need a lot of properties of algebraic numbers. So what is the property of Liouville numbers, of algebraic numbers that Liouville proved? He proved that if you have given an algebraic irrational number, there exists a constant C, which is positive and depends only on alpha, which can be computed. It's not algebraic number alpha. There exists a constant which depends on alpha, such that for all P over Q, which are rational numbers, which means Q is greater than or equal to 1 and P is an integer, we have alpha minus P over Q greater than C of alpha divided by Q power D. So I should say that my algebraic number alpha has degree D. So it's a root of a polynomial of degree D. So this is a property that Liouville proved for all algebraic irrational numbers. Let me just explain why to assume that the number is irrational is not a big problem. That this property is true for rational numbers is plain. So if alpha is rational, say alpha equal A over B, if you take a number P over Q, of course, if you take P over Q equal alpha, then this fails. But if you take P over Q, which is different from alpha, so if you remove irrational, you have just to add the fact that P over Q is not equal to alpha. If P over Q is different from alpha, the difference alpha minus P over Q is just QA minus PB divided by QB. Now we use the fundamental fact that I mentioned before. The numerator QA minus PB is an integer which is non-zero. And therefore, it is at least 1. So this is at least 1 over QB. And this is what you have with D equal 1. And indeed, a rational number has degree 1. And you have C of alpha, which is 1 over B. So this result is true if the number is rational, provided that you assume P of Q is not equal to alpha. So this is the proof of the result in the special case of rational numbers. And the proof of Liouville is not so complicated in the general case. The idea of the proof is to write the minimal polynomial of alpha, as I did before, and you substitute P over Q to the variable x. So you look at A0, P over Q power D, plus A1, P over Q, D minus 1, plus AD. Since I assume that the number is irrational, we know that D is at least 2. And since the polynomial has the smallest degree, it is the minimal polynomial, this polynomial does not vanish at P of Q. So this is a rational number, which is non-zero, and therefore this is greater than or equal to 1 over Q to the D, which is the denominator here. So this is the 1 over D which is there, and then it's not difficult to check that the left-hand side is bounded by C of alpha. C of alpha times alpha minus P of Q. I will not say more about that, but this is an exercise. So this is a property from Liouville, which is satisfied by all algebraic numbers. Now we want to get a number which does not satisfy this property. The first example, which was given by Liouville, used continued fraction by taking a sequence of A0, A1, A2, which grows very fast. And then, in another paper, Liouville gave other examples which involve expansion or decimal expansion. If you take the number sum greater for n greater than or equal to 1 over 2 to the n factorial, you can put 10 if you prefer the decimal expansion rather than the binary one. If you take this number, this number is very well approximated by Pn over Qn, which is the sum for, say, P capital N over Q capital N, the sum for n equal 1 to capital N of 1 over 2 to the n factorial. So you take Qn equal 1 over 2 to the n factorial. This is the denominator. Pn is just given by this property. And then you deduce easily that this number does not satisfy the conclusion of Liouville's statement. The difference, if you multiply Qn to the n by this number, say x, x minus Pn over Qn, this tends to zero. And therefore, there is no fixed exponent for which we would have this inequality. So these are the examples of Liouville. And the numbers for which we can prove that they are transcendental, so this is transcendental, the numbers that we can prove to be transcendental using this result are called Liouville numbers. These Liouville numbers play a very important role in the theory of dynamical systems. And at the end of the last lecture, I will speak a little bit more of dynamical systems. The Liouville, the numbers which are very well approximated by rational numbers, play a very special role in the behavior of the dynamical systems. When you have some map with a rotation number, the fact that the rotation number is Liouville or not makes a big difference on the behavior of the system. Okay, so it's a question which I like very much. Because when you have a set, subset of R, you can ask, is it a big set or a small set? And there are several ways of defining this. One is to look at Lebesgue's measure. And you will say, a set is big if it has Lebesgue's measure 1. From this point of view, Liouville numbers are very small. It's a set of measure 0. But there are other ways of defining what is a big set. And in particular, there is the definition of G delta set in the category of Baer. And in this case, the Liouville numbers are large because it's a G delta set. So the set of Liouville numbers is uncountable. It's a big set in the sense of Baire, and it's a small set in the sense of Lebesgue. It turns out that in my genealogy, Baire is one of my ancestors. He was a thesis advisor of someone, and it goes to Fresnel and to me. And so I would be tempted to say that there are many Liouville numbers because of Baire. Okay, so the Diophantine approximation is this kind of low bound. We have some numbers, and we can say that it is well or badly approximated by rational numbers or by algebraic numbers. And this kind of low bound is the one which is the most useful in transcendence proofs. Again, I repeat that most transcendence proofs rest on some inequality of this type, which belongs to transcendental number, to Diophantine approximation. Now, I need to go a little bit deeper in the transcendence proofs, and for that, I will select some examples, and I will give some sketch of proof. Of some transcendence result. And I chose the so-called Hermite-Lindemann theorem. You see, Cantor proved that there are infinitely many transcendental numbers, but they are not explicit. Liouville proved also that there are infinitely many transcendental numbers. He gives examples, but these examples are not examples which arise from analysis. Well, there are limits of series, but they occur because they are constructed just to fit the statement and to deduce the transcendence. The first result on the transcendence of numbers, which was classical, is due to Hermite in 1872, when Hermite proved that the number E is transcendental. It was known that E is irrational by the result of Euler on the continuous fraction expansion. I told you that there are some easier proofs of the irrationality of E. And one of these proofs was considered by Liouville, before Hermite. And the irrationality of E is one of the statements of the theory which is easy to prove, and even if it is deep. And the proof is to write E equal 1 plus 1 over 1 factorial plus 1 over 2 factorial plus 1 over n factorial. And then you look at the number Qn equal n factorial and the number Pn, which is Qn times the truncated series. And if you look at QNE minus PN, you get that it is a positive number. QNE is less than PN. Well, E is greater than PN over QN. But this is small. And if you look at how small it is, you deduce that the limit of QNE minus Pn is 0. And the argument which I used before to prove the irrationality of some number applies to get the irrationality of E. So this is an argument of Diophantine approximation, but it's not sufficient for the transcendence. And the proof of Hermite is very interesting. It's a very nice paper. He starts by explaining some analogy between the approximation of numbers and the approximation of functions. And this is in this paper that he introduces the notion of approximation of function, which became Padé approximation. Padé was a student of Hermite, so he came after. But Padé made a systematic study of the approximation of function. And Padé approximant is something which is used in many places in analysis. From the correspondence of Hermite, it is clear that what he wanted to prove is the transcendence of pi. And this was the main challenge at that time, because it was known that if the number pi were proved to be transcendental, the problem of squaring the circle would not have a solution using the ruler and the compass. And Hermite wrote, those who will try to prove the transcendence of pi will have a hard time. And it was done, so this was 1872 or 3. And it was done by Liouville, by Lindemann in 1888. And Lindemann proved that the number pi is transcendental. And the basic ideas are those of Liouville, but something more was needed. And it took many years before Lindemann solved the problem. And what is known as the Hermite-Lindemann theorem is a result which contains both. It says that if alpha is algebraic, so it's a complex algebraic number, which is non-zero, then exponential of alpha is a transcendental number. So if you take alpha equal 1, you get that e exponential of 1 is a transcendental number. If you take alpha equal I pi, exponential of alpha is minus 1, so it's algebraic, and therefore I pi is transcendental. And then the pi is transcendental. So I would like to give some idea of the proof of Hermite-Lindemann theorem. And I find it easier to explain the proof on a more general result, which will explain which are the properties of the exponential function which are used. In the proof of Hermite and then of Lindemann, there were many properties of the exponential function which were used. In particular, to get Padé approximation, it was necessary to use only the exponential function. But then, thanks to the development of the theory, mainly due to Ziegel, it was possible to give a proof which applies to a larger collection of special functions. And this kind of result was developed by Schneider, who gave a very nice criterion which involves some functions satisfying some properties. The only drawback is that the statement of Schneider takes a very big page, a complicated statement with a lot of assumptions. And it was simplified by Lang, and this gives the so-called Schneider-Lang criterion. I will give only a very special case. And I will discuss what is a more general case. We start with one function, and this function will be the exponential function. We have a function f, which is an analytic function. It is analytic in the plane. We say that it is an entire function. So it is analytic in C. Or holomorphic, if you prefer, with one variable. We assume that it is not a polynomial, which is the case for the exponential function. We assume that it satisfies a differential equation. And this is where I give a very special statement. The differential equation, which I am considering, is that the derivative of f is a polynomial, say A, in z and f of z. Much more general differential equations are allowed, but at least for the exponential function, this is true. The exponential of z, the derivative is just f prime is equal f. The next object we need to introduce is a number field. Not a polynomial. Oh, excuse me, I did not say what is A. So, A is a polynomial. Okay, so let me say that A is a polynomial with coefficients in a number field, XY. So, K is a number field. So, I did not define what is a number field. A number field is just a set which is obtained starting from Q by adding finitely many algebraic numbers. If you prefer, it's a field which is a finite extension of Q. So it's a field which contains Q and is a vector space of a Q of finite dimension. But if you prefer, you just take K equal Q to start with. But no, this would not be sufficient for the transcendence of e to the alpha. So K is a number field. And then the conclusion is the following. If you look at the set of alpha in K, such that f of alpha is in K, this set is finite. So this is the criterion of Schneider-Lang in a very special case. So why do you deduce the Hermite-Lindemann theorem? So the corollary. Hermite-Lindemann, you take f of z equal exponential of z, and you take the field q of alpha and exponential of alpha. If alpha and exponential of alpha are both algebraic, k is a number field. So the polynomial a is just y. Oh, I forgot to an assumption on f. I forgot to say that there is an assumption of f which is required for the proof of the statement. It is not clear that it is required for the statement, but we say that f has a finite order of growth. So what does it mean that f is an entire function of finite order? It means that f of z is less than or equal to a constant exponential modulus of z to the power rho, where c and rho are just two positive numbers. And so for the exponential function, we have rho equal 1 and c equal 1. So. And now we look at this set, which is here. This set contains, OK, so maybe to be more clear, I should say the set of gamma in K, so that f of gamma is in K. You take gamma, all the multiples of alpha. And this set is infinite because we have assumed that alpha is non-zero. And so the conclusion is not satisfied, and therefore, K cannot be a number field. One of the two numbers, alpha and exponential of alpha, is transcendental. So I say that this is a special case. It's a special case for many reasons. One of them is that we deal with entire function. The result is true for meromorphic functions. For meromorphic function, we need to explain what it means that there is a finite order of growth. A meromorphic function is just a quotient of two entire functions, and the order of growth is just the maximum of the order of growth of the numerator and denominator. So the result is true for meromorphic function. And apart from that, the statement is the same. What is more important is that we can allow more general differential equation. So instead of the function E, we get the result when we take elliptic functions like Weierstrass elliptic function, or we can take Jacobi elliptic function, Sn, Cn. We can take also the function zeta and sigma, which are associated with P. We are not able to do with zeta, which is Riemann zeta function. This is Weierstrass zeta function. We can work also with the Abelian function. But Abelian functions are functions of several variables. This is a statement on one variable, and I will discuss tomorrow the extension of transcendence method to several variables, but there are such statements. Also, the method which I am going to explain, the sketch of proof which I will give, works to deal with other special functions like Bessel functions. So, what is the idea of the proof? I will split it in five steps, and after that, I will discuss the steps essentially tomorrow. The first step is the introduction of what is called an auxiliary function. So maybe I can explain you the idea. We have a function which is not a polynomial. There is an easy result of complex analysis which say that if a function is not a polynomial, then whenever you take a polynomial in z and f of z, this polynomial is not the zero function. In other terms, if you have an entire function which is algebraic of C of z, then it is a polynomial. So the idea is the following. If you have a polynomial p with coefficients in k of xy, which is not the zero polynomial, then the function p of z and f of z is not the zero function because f is not a polynomial. And so we want to get an upper bound for this, so we will use the fact that for all polynomial p, p of z and f of z is not zero. And so we will introduce a polynomial p for which this function is small, but it will not be the zero function. What means small? It means that if you take a large disk, this function takes only small values. And the idea is that for the first step, which is an auxiliary polynomial, there is a very nice book which was published last year by David Masser on auxiliary polynomial in transcendence proofs. And this is one example. So the auxiliary polynomial is to show that there exists a polynomial p in xy, so that the function f of z equal p of z and f of z has many zeros. and we ask only finitely many conditions. We ask that the derivative at the point alpha are zero for alpha 1, alpha n, which are in the set, I will take the notation gamma. Gamma 1, gamma n, which are in the set which is there, so they are in k, and the f of gamma I are in k. And the goal is to get an upper bound for n, to show that n cannot be infinite. So we will get an upper bound for n. And so we have n points, and we take the derivative in a finite range. So we have finitely many conditions which are here. We have the coefficients of p which are unknown, so we have finitely many unknowns. And these relations are homogeneous linear relations in the coefficient of p. So if we have more equations, more unknowns than equations, we know that there is a solution. So I will come back to this auxiliary polynomial, but this auxiliary polynomial depends on the degree of p with respect to x and to y. And so there's L0, maybe I put strictly less like this. I have L0, L1 coefficients. I have Tn equations. And in the construction, in the existence of the auxiliary polynomial, we will choose L0, L1, Tn, so that L0, L1 is greater than Tn. This is sufficient to ensure the existence of such a polynomial. Linear algebra is not quite sufficient for the first step, but I will come back to that tomorrow. The second step is the so-called zero estimate. We know that this function is not the zero function, so there are points where it does not vanish. And the zero estimate is to find some t0, and which is an integer greater than or equal to t. And we have some gamma I0, which is one of the elements which are here. So one between I0 and n, so that the derivative of gamma I0 is non-zero. So let me denote this number by xi. If I write it like this, it's trivial, because the function is not zero, and so there are such T0 and I0, and we can take them minimal. In practice, this will be sufficient for this statement here. But for Hermite, the situation was much more difficult, and this was a very difficult step, the zero estimate. And it became, difficult for many works like Lindemann, Gelfand, Schneider. But in this case, it is rather easy. Okay, so this is the second step. Now we have this number xi. What we do with xi is to give an upper bound for xi. So you see that xi is the derivative of an analytic function which has many zeros. So there is some tool which is called Schwarz's lemma in complex analysis. Which states that if you have a function with many zeros, then this function is rigid. It should be small on a large disk. And so this is just due to the fact that xi is a derivative of a function at gamma zero. This is the part of the proof on which I plan to give the most details tomorrow, because this is a very rich topic, especially when we are interested in several variables. So the Schwarz-Lemma in one variable is easy, and I will give the proof tomorrow. But in several variables, it raises a lot of very interesting questions, which are related with the DiBa estimate, L2 estimates for the DiBa operator of Ermander, Bombieri, and Skoda. And this yields some very interesting questions about some invariants related with the Seychadris constant. The fourth step is to prove that Xi is not too small. Xi is an algebraic number. It is the derivative of the function f. So Xi is an element in K. And Xi is not zero. And we have a tool for that, which is Liouville estimate. So this is just Liouville estimate, the fourth step. And I will come back also to this fourth step tomorrow. And the last step, we write what are epsilon 1 and epsilon 2, and we deduce an upper bound for n. So there is nothing mysterious for that, because I do not say what are epsilon 1, epsilon 2, so it's just hand waving. And so maybe it's a good time now that I stop on this hand waving. Thank you very much.
Function field extension is transcendental, a lot of special values are transcendental. Qz, Qz, comma e to the z.
Yes.
That's transcendental.
Yes.
Hence, a lot of special values of e to the z are transcendental. That's a kind of...
This is true. So when I said what are the properties of the exponential function that we need, I mentioned the differential equation, and I did not mention the addition theorem, exponential of x plus y is exponential of x times exponential of y. We use a weak version of that. We just use that exponential of nx is exponential of x to the power n. So when we do not have an addition theorem like the exponential function, we need to have many points, sufficiently many points. But for the elliptic function, abelian function, even zeta function, we have some addition theorem, so it works like that. But you're right that once we have a transcendental value, then we have many others.
So if there are no further questions, let's thank Professor Wolfschmidt, and we will meet tomorrow in JNU for the second term.
Thank you.